Amen. First, we want to just tell the Lord, thank you.
Thank you.
Amen for all that he has done and what he's doing right now.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Amen.
A lot of times we as people, we get to do what we're doing, it's all over.
Yes, sir.
But he do what he do and he never stop doing.
That's right.
We want to just tell God, amen. Thank you.
Amen.
Now on tonight, I feel kind of like a Pastor Cross, kind of feel like a fish out of water.
Yeah.
What do you feel like?
It's been how many weeks? Since I stood up here, I've been trying to preach. Been standing before you guys there for a while on Wednesday night, but see what the Lord is going to do here on tonight. We are so glad just to be here, amen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Someone will come and get me. We'll pass these out. I just want to rehearse some things here on tonight.
Yeah.
Man. Probably won't. Watch this now, y'all. Listen close. Probably won't instill nothing in you new tonight.
Yeah.
Because 9 chance out of 10, what I want to talk about, you already so I'm not looking to do a whole lot of instilling nothing new in you. I just want to try to refresh what's already in us. Amen?
Already.
Yeah. And we do that. And that's what God keeping me is to be refreshed every now and then. That's the reason why the older generation, older folks were so hung up on revival. They felt like that designated time, that was the only time that man could be saved. Plus it was a time to refresh those who already were saved. So on tonight, we just want to refresh our memories tonight and kind of look at our lessons tonight for God is able.
Yeah.
And he is an awesome God. And you know, it's just amazing. The thing that you and I was set up to benefit ourselves, if we would set it up and then go back and check what God has set up for us to benefit us. I promise you that you will see a difference in what you set up to benefit you and what God set up to benefit you. Because if the truth is told, none of us will deliberately set up and volunteer for some trials and some trials. But God has a way of doing things that is contrary to our way of thinking. But the thing that God does for us is what's best for us. Amen?
Yes, sir.
And there are a lot of Christian folks that will never really experience all of the good things that God has on his shelf for us.
Yeah.
Now remember, it's on the shelf.
Yeah.
Some things, some good things that God have on the shelf for us. And I remember when I was at home with Mama, she would wintertime, you know, as old folks would do, they would buy them apples and cook them and put them in a jar.
Yeah.
What you call them? Put a top on it. Put a top on this. Someone thump that top, you know. But anyway, they put that there and put it on the shelf. And then when they put it on the shelf, when they got ready for it, Robin, it was on the shelf.
Yeah.
and what they would do. It was something on the shelf that was good for. And what they would do, they would get up, you know, and they'd go in there in the pantry or wherever it was. Yeah. They would go to the shelf.
Yeah.
And then they would get what was on the shelf. Apples, peaches, and what have you. And something that would fit into to you and I. Yeah. The only thing that I'm saying is, you know, God got some things on the shelf.
All right.
Y'all hear what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And what God have on the shelf, you don't just need it in the wintertime.
Yeah.
We need it all the time.
Yes, sir.
Mama and them canned things and put it up and they save it until the wintertime. Mm-hmm. And that's what we need the most of the evening. But what God have on the shelf for you and I, it's needed at all times, but it's on the shelf.
Yeah.
And some of us will never get a chance to enjoy what's on the shelf simply because we cannot accept the plan that God, I'm finna say something, has set up for us.
All right.
Did y'all catch that?
Yes, sir.
God has set up some plans for you and I that's good for us. But we have a hard time trying to agree with what God has set up for us. On tonight, we're going to be in the book of James. One, just left this church here, one of the churches that was 12 churches that spread it out over Asia Minor. James is one of the writers. He's writing to the 12 churches. And those 12 churches back then are symbolic, or they represented the church world as a whole, amen?
Yes.
So he wrote those, one that was scattered. And church was scattered at one time because church was going through persecution.
Yes.
And you know, people don't like to hang out in one spot, especially there's some persecution.
All right.
Y'all hear what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
If there's trouble, folks don't want to hang out in that spot right there. Right. I'm glad I said that. I am glad I said that.
Yeah.
Because a thought came to me. Sometimes you have to say something. You know, sometimes you just think and thoughts come. But then y'all hear what I'm saying? Sometimes you got to say something. When you say something, then a thought will come.
That's right.
I'm glad I said that because when I said that, I thought about the being in a place where persecution is, and I thought about the fact that God said to the church, Jesus said, after the Holy Ghost have come upon you, you shall be witnesses of me in Jerusalem, Samaria, Judea, and to the utmost parts of the world. When the Holy Ghost came upon the church, watch this now, and Peter got preaching, and all those folks got saved, and guess what the church did? Stayed in Jerusalem.
Yeah.
Stayed in it, didn't they? Stayed right there in Jerusalem.
Yep.
And guess what got them out of Jerusalem? Persecution.
Yeah.
The Bible said, Paul said he ran them out of Jerusalem. They left Jerusalem going to Damascus. But if they had got out of Jerusalem like God told them, they never would have to suffer that persecution.
All right.
So a lot of times we don't move. And because we don't move and we don't do what God said do.
Yeah.
After God have, I knew I'm talking to somebody.
Yeah.
After God have, after God have commanded us what to do, and we just sit around and don't do it. And see, you got to see what you're doing. When you're sitting there, you're trying to save yourself and be comfortable in your box. That what the church, but see, God told them, now listen, now y'all, you read now, I'm going to get to the lesson, but he said, read now. I'm telling you what to do when you get what I'm going to send you. Because right now you don't have it, but say, after you receive the Holy Ghost, I want you to get out of town, get out of Jerusalem. And see, we sitting around sometimes, we do the same thing. Sitting around here trying to protect our own interests, you know, in our own little box, you know, concerned about ourselves, you know, and want to, and trying to have the best for ourselves. But the Lord wanted the church to get out of Jerusalem so the rest of the folk can be exposed to the best that God had.
Yeah.
See, if we get busy and do what God tells us to do, then we can expose other folks to the goodness and the mercy of God. And if you just sit still, there's nothing going to happen. You know, you could be you could be good as a Coca-Cola.
All right,
Coke is now in the world over.
Yeah.
You could be good at Coke. Right. But if don't nobody know anything about you,
all right,
you have the good coke in the corner. All right, so this writing, Jane writing to the church that was scattered abroad, mm-hmm. one who was under persecutions. Mm-hmm. They had been persecuted, so they scattered. So let's look how Jane start this off. He said, a servant of God mm-hmm. and of the Lord Jesus Christ
yeah.
to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. Jane is greeting him. Let's just know to listen. He is a what? A servant of God. He's a servant of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Yes.
Letting people know that he's not just a renegade. He's not a crook. But he is connected to Christ and church folk. I said church folks, mm-hmm. ought to be connected to Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
If church folks are not really connected to Jesus Christ, they're not really real church folks. Mm-hmm. Just look at that right there. Facing trials and benefiting from the trials that you face. That's saying something there. That's something to think about. That's something that some of us could not swallow. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So that's something some of us, we're not willing to take that chance. We don't see no benefits in it for us because we're not looking out of the eyes of God. So what do you think about that? I mean, just that statement right there. Facing trials and benefiting from them. Somebody tell me your thoughts about that.
No pain, no gain.
What you say, preacher?
No pain, no gain.
All right. Anybody else got anything you want to say about that?
Well, God, but the devil meant for bad, God meant for
good. Okay, you sound like a what now?
Growth process.
A growth process? Okay, you said it sound like a growth process. Okay, but everybody don't see it that way. Some people can't see. I got to suffer before I grow.
Use that word.
Somebody don't see it that way. And what did you say, Sister Hasha?
I was just saying what the devil means for bad, God means for good.
God means for good. Okay. What the devil meant for bad, God means it's for our good. Okay. And some of us can't see what God has already set out for our good. Because sometimes it's going to cause a little pain. So, but James instructed the church, and he said, now listen, I know y'all are already under persecution. Y'all are already dealing with some trials and some tribulation. But now, James said that since that's something that the church going to be entangled with, as long as the church is the church, because see, there's never been a time that the church were exempted from prosecutions, trials, and tribulations. If you check the record of the church, ever since the church has been in existence, the church have had to go through some things. And so that's the reason why it's very important that we as God's folks, I'm going to go somewhere right now, stay to God's word. You got to know God's word because guess what? Now you are in this thing, the body of Christ, we are in it, and there's no existence, we are not exempted from the trials and all of the tribulations and all these pitfalls of life. So there, since you're not exempted from it, now you need to know how to what? Handle it.
All right.
Am I making any sense?
Yeah.
And if you know how to handle it, you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's not hard for me to get to the other side of a 20-foot swimming pool, 65 feet wide, if I know how to swim.
Yeah.
I ain't got to jump it. I can't jump that far. But if I know how to what?
Swim,
I can do what? Get to the other side. So the only thing that I'm saying about the church is, listen, we cannot jump over trials and tribulation and all these things that come up on the church. But there's one thing about it, if we study God's word, we can learn how to deal with it. And then we will see the benefits to us.
Yeah.
According to the word of God.
All right.
Amen.
Amen.
Now I said a whole lot of in 10 minutes.
Yeah.
I really have, because now listen, God said my way are not your way.
Yeah.
And your way is not mine. We don't even much think alike.
Yeah.
This is what the Lord is saying.
Yeah.
You are thinking one way, but God said, it's not your way. It's all about me. So listen how James started this thing off in verse number, and I'm quoting on our paper here, it says from chapter 1, verse 2 through 4, it talks about accept them into my trial as a means of growth. You got to accept them as a means of growth. Let me just read those verses real quick then. Dear Jay, listen. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptation, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. So it looks like to me that James is saying, we have to accept trials and tribulation as a means of growth. Mm-hmm. So really what he's saying, if we're not going to accept trials and tribulation, we will continue to be on milk.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now that's what it sounds like to me.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes. There is no growth.
Mm-hmm.
Christian growth. Mm-hmm. I'm not talking about weight, gaining weight now.
Yeah.
There is no Christian growth
mm-hmm.
if we are not willing to accept the trials of life. That's the first thing we want to run our way. We can't stand none of it. God already set it up to benefit you.
Mm-hmm.
Trials and tribulation.
Mm-hmm.
Set up to benefit you.
Mm-hmm.
But because somebody said you don't have to go through that.
Mm-hmm.
But James said to the church, and it is evident, listen, when we read the word of God, that troubles are going to come.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're going to come. And read, listen to what James said. My brethren, count it all joy. He said, count it all joy. When you fall into divers temptation, many temptation, different kinds of trials and tribulation. He said, count it all joy. When? Not if, but he said, when. You hear what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, listen, when rules out you being good, and because you've been good, you ought to be able to be, you know, not to have to deal with them.
Yeah.
So the thing about it, he said, count it all joy when. So that says to me, when he said, count it all joy when you fall, that says to me, whether you of doing your best as a child of God, you're going to be exposed to trial.
Yes,
and you might be one of those left hand crooks in church. You're going to be exposed, and you might be walking the straight and narrow, but you are exposed. So he said, "Count it all joy when lets us know that there is no way around." Yeah. Child. No way around. Are there any comments?
That's good.
Yes, sir.
Verse 2.
Yes, sir.
Was it counted all joy?
Yeah.
So, just from looking at, you know, as we dive into the fact that we will deal with the temptation, James is telling us the attitude we ought to have in the midst of the trying situation.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of times, when we deal with some difficulty, our attitude changes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So James started out saying, count it all joy. Mm-hmm.
Count it all joy. Count it all joy. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, and you know, watch this right here. Now, some of us won't agree with this, but you know what? We really have an advantage on grandmama and great-grandmama.
Because
when great-grandmama and great-great-grandmama, if they had been able to pick up this book here and it read same way it reads out, my brother would have counted all joy. They never would have known that word.
Yeah.
Because they could not read.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But you and I, God have blessed us.
Yeah. Yeah.
We are intelligent creatures now.
Yeah.
So therefore, when we read the word of God, listen, we have forewarning.
Yeah.
We are aware
yeah.
of some things that's coming our way, some things that we should do before we have to do it.
Yeah.
I know I said something. You're already aware. It ain't like, you know, listen, if that like stuff got to slip up on you and I, we already know, according to the word, if we believe the word of God,
right.
The trials are coming. We already know that, don't we?
Right. Yeah.
So therefore, what we do, we prepare ourselves for the arrival. Of trials and tribulation.
Mm-hmm.
We are ready for it. So what do you think that we really had the advantage on the one on the people back in the back yonder that really could not read and could not understand?
Mm-hmm.
We have forewarning.
Yeah.
So all we got to do is heed
right.
to God's warning.
Yeah.
But a lot of times we don't heed to it. And most times when people don't heed to it, that's not the way they want it.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Just you know, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh what?
Patience.
The trying of your faith worketh patience. A man or a woman without trial, listen, you ain't got to have no faith.
Faith.
But the Bible said, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh
patience.
Mm-hmm. But let patience have a what? Perfect work. That ye may be perfect, mature, what it says, and entire. Wanting nothing.
My Lord.
So listen, it looked like to me that patience got a lot to do with
yes.
a child of God, the walk.
Mm-hmm.
We're running around here talking about how much faith we have. But look like to me, you can have the faith, but if you don't have the patience, it seemed like to me reading the word of God, that a lack of patience will wreck your faith.
Yeah.
I got faith that God can do this, but do you have patience to wait till he do it?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Sound like on Sunday morning. Go ahead.
Well, you're talking there, and something happened to me this week. I got a ticket on university coming down the hill and the sign, I looked up at the sign and I was doing 35 and a policeman jumped out in the middle of the street and pulled me over.
Yeah, do that.
I didn't get angry because now I knew that I was wrong. So I said, he said, well, Mr. Sims, I won't get, if you go down there and pay your ticket, then I won't put it on your insurance company. I'm still patient. I get down now, and the lady told me, I said, well, I come down here, I got a ticket. She said, well, it's already in. I said, how much is it? She said, $215, and I come out blue. I like to go to jail.
How much you pay?
$215 for doing in a 25-mile-an-hour, and I was doing 35 miles an hour because I was coming down here. That makes no difference. Like you were saying, it makes no difference. I should have been, as a child of God, I should have been patient enough to wait on it. But when he said $215. I come on blue, sure. 25 miles an hour. First thing I said,
I don't tell us that. I've
never been to jail. I never did anything wrong. I've never been in a robbery. I never did. But you gonna charge me $215 for a ticket? Now I was wrong, true enough. But when you saying patient, that's what self. Patient has self got a lot to do with that patient because. Self ain't gonna let patient wait on the circumstances because I didn't understand that. And so I shouted so loud they sent two cops out. So now I was talking now. And so when they come out, they tried to explain to me. And that's when my patience come in. I stood right in front of them, looked at them real strange, and counted to 10 and walked off.
Did you pay?
Something come over me saying, no, Jerry. Because I was finna clown. You know, but this is what I'm trying to say. When you say patience, we all counted all that joy. I couldn't count that. So self come into existence.
Wouldn't be very happy.
But Brother Deacon, you know, and it's a fact.
Yeah.
That you was beating. You see what I'm saying?
They said if you're going 15 miles over the speed limit where you're driving, your ticket gonna be 200 or more. If you're going 15 miles, I got a ticket a couple weeks ago. First ticket I had in 25 years. So, but I
deserve to speak. What I'm trying to say about my actions.
Okay.
Of what we said.
And the thing about it, this right here. Listen, it just calls in how people, what kind of day folks are having when they stop you. Okay? DOT has stopped me and folks that are affiliated with me. One to tell me one thing, and I go down the road and talk to another one, he'll tell me something else.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But the thing about it is this, you were speeding, you know, it might not seem right, but that's the law.
Yeah.
And God didn't break the law.
No.
Yeah, man. Broke the law, but you know what? It's a good thing you had some sound like to me. Just impatient or something.
Yeah.
Because of you might have been about to get out of, you know, you might have missed Bible study. and you know what? Watch this right here. And really what James is really, he said, count it all joy. And you know, I think that we ought to, as God's people, ought to be counted joy that God Himself cared enough for us hellbound folks to save us.
Yeah.
If you could kind of think about Calvary and where you was headed and what God had done for you, that'll help you to get through a whole lot of those situations that Jerry got caught up in.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Sister Tasha.
When you were talking about it, count it all joy, I was thinking about when Robin's car was stolen about 19 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And we it was stolen. We had no idea where it was. And I remember coming to church before we moved over here. Coming to church, and I testified, and I got joy. I was saying that it was a car, you know, and I could not get, it wasn't my daughter that they stole, it was the car that they stole.
Yeah.
So I endured that. We went home and endured it, and everything came, you know, a lot of things went through changes, but we never lost any joy over it.
Mm-hmm.
And 12 years later, somebody stole my Mercedes out of my garage. So what did I do? Yeah, the car was, the door was up and the keys were in there, but the car wasn't moving, you know, somebody in. What I had to do was to go to Union District the next day, because it was doing Union District, and I had to testify that somebody stole my car last night. So I'm in the truck today. Because I had no idea where the car was. I just never lost any faith over it. It could have been that I knew the transmission was bad and the air conditioner wasn't working. But they stole it. And with my book, good Bible in it, where I had all your old sermons in it. With good, I said, they're going to be mad at me as long as they don't come and get it. But I had patience. And I said, God might have, when they got the first car stolen, and I was able to have joy, now they're going to take some of mine out of my house, because the garage is your house, you know. But I still had patience, and they called me and gave me a check for the car, and I got another car. But my thing was, I had to endure that. You know, it wasn't fun for go in your house and run in the bathroom, you come back out and say, Charles, did you move the car? Because it ain't here. So, you know, but he fixed my heart so I could understand. I had joy, but I wasn't happy and glad. But I did not lose my joy over God, because it could have been a lot worse in both cases. It could have been a lot worse. But I remember this verse from that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Count it all joy when you come into these tests and all these trials and all this stuff that happens. Don't lose your joy in Christ. Don't lose it. That's what I got out of it. That when I had first read it, you know, when they say count it all joy, it don't mean don't go around grinning and bragging and talking about, you know, but have joy in the Lord, that it could have been worse. And he has a place prepared for us without a car.
And listen, James said, in this letter, Silver said, listen, we can accept them as a mean of growth from a trial.
Yeah.
And listen, see, sometimes we, as people, we get to where we think that we cannot live.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just simple stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes we feel like we can't make it without a car.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
but God said, I can, listen now, if you depend on me, listen, I can get you to where you need to go.
Uh-huh.
You might not get all the place you want to go,
all right,
but God can fix it to where he needs you to go. Amen?
Uh-huh.
So now, watch this here. Most of us, you know, people, especially the ones that have insurance, you know, homeowners insurance and stuff like that, and you know, you know yourself, that your house got burned out.
Mm-hmm.
And you didn't satisfy it, it just got burned.
Mm-hmm.
And now you cut all up and raise his hand and calling God a criminal and not, you know, mad with God. And watching him. And you know yourself that now, look here, that the windows, the air was blowing all the way. It didn't have to open the door to get the air. The air was coming through the cracks and coming through the pain, through the floor and all. You raising all that hell, you know. And God ain't doing nothing but getting ready. You got to ensure God ain't going up and getting ready. You hear what I'm talking about? He's getting ready to bless you, but now you raising hell. Fire going over that no windows house there and about to lose your joy and everything else, you know. And listen, at the end of the day, at the end of the day, now you got a house.
Yeah.
Y'all hear what I'm saying? Got good window?
Yeah.
Doors closed. you got all of this right here. And you raising all that hell. You see what I'm talking about. God said, now listen, it's hard on me. In a better house.
Yeah.
They done got mad and stopped going to church. And I'm trying to get them to a place for putting them in a better house. Trying to give them a better job.
Yeah.
And pastor.
Oh, I got another hand that Deacon. Look here. But preaching.
When you look at verses 2, 3, and 4 collectively, and I think about the fact that because we're all growing in grace, you will never have a personal experience of God being a healer if you ain't never been sick.
All right.
That's right.
You can't testify about him being a provider if you've never been in a position where you had to go without.
Yeah.
That's right.
If you've always got money, if everything is straight, you know, where's your trust in the Lord coming from? Because you've never had to just lean on him.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, sometimes God, you know, he may have to take the car with you. And after a while, he give you up.
That's right.
It's all in the process.
Call an air condition.
Us learning to depend on him.
That's right. That's right. Oh, did you hear your hand? Go ahead.
In the book of Job, it says in there that one day the sons of God came before him, and Satan came also.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord asked Satan where he had been, and Satan said, going to and fro in the world, seeking whom he may devour.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord asked him, had you considered my servant Job, that there's none like him, that he's a perfect man, one that shuns the very appearance of evil.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Lord allowed Satan to do what he did to Job. That was a trial and a test that was designed by God for Job. All of us have trials and tribulations that are designed by God for us. Mine are different from everybody else's. We may go through some similar experiences, but my trials and tribulations are different, and they are sent to me. They come to me by way of God giving Satan he gives him a certain amount of power or a certain amount of permission.
Yeah.
That's the word I'm looking for. To do what he's going to do in our lives. And the scripture also tells us that there's nothing that has come upon us that there has not been given a way out.
That's right.
A way out. So these trials and tribulations that come up on us, there is a way out of all of them.
Mm-hmm.
And they are designed for us.
Mm-hmm.
Sister Pam may be able to handle something I can't handle.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever God has for her to handle, he sends her way. And whatever he has for me to handle, he sends my way. And we're all supposed, as you were teaching now, we're supposed to count it all joy, because that's supposed to be growth, and it's all for God's, for our good, and for God's glory. It all is. But each one is designed. My trials are not the same as Alan's. Alan's are not the same as mine. But all the way through those trials, God never ever leaves us. He never leaves us.
That's right. Watch this right here. Thank you, Sister Matthew.
Yes, sir.
I agree with all of that. Watch this right here. Look at what Job went through and the thing that Job went through.
Yes.
Not only Job trial really wasn't so much a beneficial for Job only.
That's right. That's right.
Look at what Job went through.
Yes, sir.
Job dead now.
Yeah.
But guess what? It's benefiting us.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? We are being benefited. So the only thing that I'm saying is, you know, a lot of times when we go through stuff, God allows us to go through it. And if we go through it, and come through it right, then other folks can benefit from us. Watch it right here. You don't, this table here is a table of trial.
Right.
Our blood is approaching this table. I don't grow as I approach this table. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Now, if I get to the table, and if I jump over the table, I don't grow on the other side of the table. Y'all know where I'm going. And what I'm simply trying to tell you, on this side of your child, there's not a whole lot of growth. You understand? There's a lot of praying on this side. But then on the other side of it, guess what? There's no growth on that. There's some praise and thanking God. But in the midst of the trial, that's where you do your growing. That's where you grow. You grow in the midst of what you're going through. So if you don't want to go through some trial, the small chance that you ain't going to do is a great chance, lady, that you ain't going to do a whole lot of growing. So James just wants the church to know, listen, since the church is caught up in this, these trials and tribulations and all this stuff here, and we are not exempted for it, and he was just really speaking words of comfort to the church. Words of consolation. Pastor Blood tell you, said, listen, because and the Bible said, those of us who live godly, we're going to have to suffer. So that's what the Bible said. So James is saying to the church, you want to grow up. If you're really, if Christian people are going to grow up, they're going to have to go through something, you know. So verses 2 through 4 said, accept them as means of growth. And talk about trial. And really, listen, that patience, you got to have patience. Because now it looked like to me that without patience, you know, it's going to wreck, you know, your faith in the Lord, you know, the faith that you think you already have in it. And listen to what they're talking about, verses 5 through 8, they're talking about, pray for wisdom in coping with them, in coping with trial. Pray for wisdom. Let's see what verse 5 through 8 says. Somebody read this one. Verse 5 through 8.
If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraid it not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. The double-minded man is unstable in all his ways.
That's self-explanatory there. Y'all hear what I'm saying? You ain't got to go to no seminary.
That's right.
This right here, it's just self-explained here. It says, listen, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men, otherwise freely. He really don't hold it back, you know. So now, if you lack wisdom, don't go to the world.
That's right.
See, you got to have godly wisdom to know how to handle the trial of life. Got to have wisdom. So now, why is you going to, if God going to send trial, now you going to the world for the world's wisdom. The world's wisdom don't know nothing about God's trial. They don't agree no kind of way. So James said, now if you lack wisdom, he said, ask God. Go to him. Pray to him. He will give it to you freely. He don't hold it back. I mean, it's yours for the action. Because you need wisdom. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Now, I know a lot of times wisdom, we want to hook wisdom and knowledge, you know, and thank God for knowledge. But now, he's talking about wisdom right now. Let me tell you one thing. I don't care. Let me just inject knowledge right now. I don't care how much knowledge you have. If you don't have no wisdom, you can, listen, let me put it this way. You can know that California is west of here. And you can know the exact mileage there. You never been there, and you finna go there. You don't have a GPS in your car. Now you finna go there. You heard about it, but here, watch it right here. There's a stack of maps right here on the corner. And you going to California. You never been there. You know, the folks have told you where it's at. And here's a stack of calendars, right, oh, not calendar, but map right here. 50 cents. A map. You ain't never been there. But now watch it right here. You so cheap. You won't even much spend 50 cents. Now that's wisdom. Listen. Listen. 50, all you got, listen, knowledge, listen, buy your map.
Yeah.
Why you gonna go out there trying to get them, you know? So only thing that I'm saying today, to have knowledge is one thing, but listen, to have wisdom is to know how to do. I get what you said. Here's a know, it's a way to know how, it's a wise way of doing what you know.
All right.
You didn't make any sense?
Yeah.
It's a wise way of doing what you know. So he said, now if you lack wisdom, go to God. Everything that happened to you and I, that you and I come in contact with, back there in the creation,
yeah.
God set it up, and put it put it in His timing.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
He set it up back there, and put it in His providential timing, and His gradually coming to pass. Mm-hmm. Now, if God done set it up, that last man that lied on you, and you know he lied on you, you Christian now, you know he lied on you.
Yeah.
Well. He should have been, if you had to give him, wait a minute, hold up. God signed, God set this stuff up.
Yeah.
You ain't going around what God has set up. Only thing God said, I done set it up. And in my own timing, you gonna come in contact with it.
Yeah.
Now what you need to do, y'all stay with me now. You need to make sure you go to church, go to Bible study, be in Sunday school, listen to the preacher preach on Sunday, 11 o'clock, not 11:45, because he be buying enough then. Get you a Bible and study your Bible. Listen, what I have set up is on the way. But God said, now, be in Bible study, prepare yourself. Be in Sunday school to prepare yourself. And God, what God is doing now, you mad at the man been lying on you. God said, you can't go around there. So what God doing, God just sent up in heaven with a leg cross. And he want to see how you going to handle that. He watching you to see if you going to act a fool. Or are you going to act like a child of God?
So, Pastor, you saying since you studied the word, you know, been to Sunday school, and you know, listen to the preacher preach. Now, you got all this, and God have already ordained all this. So if you don't have an understanding, go down on understanding of it. Go down on your knees and give it back to God for understanding.
Well, that kind of got me crossed there. Maybe I'm saying if you're in Bible study, you're in the right place to prepare yourself for what's coming. If you in Sunday school, you're in the right place to prepare yourself what's on your way, on the way. In church, you're in the right place to prepare yourself for what's coming. Now you're in the right place. Whether or not you accept what's going on in those places. The word of God could be all around us, some of us, jumping on us, holding us down, patting us out. and we still won't accept it. So here's a good possibility. There's a good possibility that you're in the right place. If you're in the right place, then you can prepare yourself for what's coming your way, okay? Now, my thing is this right here. Watch it here, dear. If you'd have been in all of the right places, and now trouble done hit you, and now it's about to blow your mind. Well, you're late, but that's not to say God won't help you. God will help us to get through some things that we got to get real with him. But what I'm simply saying is this right here, if y'all don't mind, let me just say it this way. Why should God have to keep on worrying himself and keep on moving, picking you up and putting you over here, picking you up on Tuesday and put you over here where you need to be, got to pick you up Wednesday and put you over here where you got to go by your house on Thursday and move you where you need to be? Why God got to do all of that to us and we got all these Bibles and go to church all of the time? Yeah. What's wrong? What's wrong? As long as I've been preaching here, I ought to be able to bring my recliner out here on Sunday morning, move that pulpit out of the way, and get my recliner, and just roll it back and rag back and just watch y'all do good things to one another.
That's what God
wasn't on
that.
And I think I deserve that, even now. But the only thing that I say is, people, listen. God has to keep on wrestling with us when he has already provided. It's what she said, the way out, the way of escape, God already provided it. Why are we hung up? Moses, well, listen, watch this here. And folks don't do it, but they're used to now. But there used to be a time, well, watch this, when people pass. When I was a boy, folks just, they went off. Y'all remember? They went off. There was not enough tissue in the church. Was not enough towel in the church. Y'all hear what I'm saying? But folks don't do that now. Because they study the word of God.
That's right. That's it.
And if you accept the word of God, you believe the word of God is true, then the word of God ought to by now, y'all hear what I said, contain your emotion. Moses, when Moses died, folks ran around there and moaning and groaning and all of this right here. God told Joshua, you go tell those folks Moses is already dead. Moses is in heaven with me. But the church is stagnated. Go tell them that morning days are all over. It's time to get up and start moving. Now I know I'm telling the truth. Go ahead, brother.
Now y'all know I've been in the church, been here at Great Road for a short time, and I've had two jobs. Tomorrow, start my third one.
Thank you.
But see, if it wasn't for this church and me coming to church, coming to Bible study, I really do believe I probably wouldn't have went the other way. Mm-hmm. But being patient, letting God work it out for me, I'm going to be all right.
Yeah.
Now, while I was doing my orientation today, well, this morning I called one of my old bosses from my previous work place, and I asked him, could I use him for reference?
Mm-hmm.
He said, no problem. So I gets to my orientation, and I'm going through orientation, and just before I go to another part of the orientation, I get a phone call. It's him.
Mm-hmm.
He wants me to come to work. But see, God done worked it out where I don't have to go back to that. So after I did my orientation, I called him back. I said, well, Fred, I said, I'm not going to be able to make it. I said, I'll start a new job tomorrow night. And he said, well, I thank you, you know, gave me blessing, whatever you want to say. But it just to show a point, if you continue to be patient, Now, I ain't been no saint now. This thing done happened since I've been in this church. But I ain't stopped coming to this.
All right.
There you go, brother.
And it's just me having faith.
Yes.
Me keeping faith.
Yes.
Knowing that if I stay with where I need to be, right here in the church, Pastor.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right here in Sunday school. And come to Sunday service. And just stay where I'm at. I'm going to be all right. And it's just having patience. I'm just having patience.
Yeah.
And I'm just letting God work with me today. Yes. Instead of doing it on my own,
yeah.
I'm letting God, you know, dictate this thing.
And, but thank you for the testimony.
Yes.
Thank you for the testimony. Let me, and I'm waiting for the close. But let me tell you something. It does not happen overnight. And those of you, just don't beat folks in the ground because it's not happening when we want it to happen. Because what was going on with you didn't happen when somebody wanted it to happen. You understand what I'm saying? But if you stay close to the Lord and stay around the Word of God and listen and keep trusting God and depending on Him and have faith in it, God will fix things. He don't fix it all, baby, all at once. But you got to show sometimes God can hold it back. You got to show some kind of commitment and some kind of love and some kind of dedication to God.
Yes.
God needs to see stuff like that. Yes. What did He tell the man I preached about Sunday morning? Go back and tell him. I heard you. You cry. I see your tear. Go on back home. Tell him I gave him 15. More years. So if you want more years, more time, want more blessing, and all of this right here that God has to offer, spend some time doing right by your sister and your brother. Amen. Now, it is 8 o'clock.